Now, you know they were in South Sudan, but there's been so many problems that they've changed. They were here in the United States, and we got to see them. And here's the letter they wrote. Greetings to all of you at the First Baptist Church, Walton. As you see, we were all together spending Christmas with our kids just before we headed back to the Congo, the 1st of January. We continue to travel periodically to South Sudan, where the situation continues to deteriorate. It is a privilege to be the hands bringing the love of Christ to these places that have seen so much suffering. Thank you for your significant support that allows us to do so. Love, Ann and Bill. P.S. I'm sending this back with friends heading to the States. So this was just to us, and they took their time to do that. And writing letters back and forth is so important. It's such a special touch. So that is why I'm asking if we could write thinking of you cards or letters or drawings from some of the children. And I'm going to be going to Nicaragua to see the Parahones. And I pass these out. Many of you have their picture right now. And it tells about the work that they are doing in Nicaragua. And if you want to, you can go on their website and find out more information. It's in the green area on the back of your card. They have pictures, all kinds of things that they are doing. And for those of you that don't know, Dr. Laura and Dr. David Parahone have been serving in remote communities in Nicaragua. They share health and hope and healing with impoverished, vulnerable people of Nicaragua through an organization called AMIS, a Ministry of Sharing, which trains and supports health promoters and communities in the rural communities. These promote local, and they help train our people to act like local doctors, diagnosing and treating the most common illnesses while focusing on the prevention through home visits, nutrition, hygiene, education, deworming, and water filterization. And the water filterization is what Becca Setta was there working on when she went. Youth groups, support groups, and prenatal care. There have been significant reductions in the number of deaths among children and women in these communities. David and Laura also received short-term mission teams and long-term volunteers who serve with AMIS. And Dr. Tonio, Cheryl's husband, is on the board of AMIS, and so he will be going now. They're on their way to Nicaragua today, so we appreciate your prayers. Carolyn's going to help them because they're also bringing the baby. And Tony will be meeting with the board of AMIS and helping Dr. Laura and Dr. Parahone to continue their work. And I will be going down on Thursday, but I have to leave Walton on Wednesday. I messed up with the time change anyway, so you know, I tend to be a little late, so I have to get to Syracuse ahead of time. So, if you have any letters that you would like to write or notes, I would be happy to hand deliver them. We are so blessed to get the letter from the Clemmers, and I know that it would mean so much to them to hear from you. God bless you, and please continue to pray for all our missionaries and to pray for us, our family, as we go down there. I will be meeting with Dr. Laura and Dr. David, so I want to give them our love from the First Baptist Church. Thank you.
Let's pray. Father, we are grateful that you are our God. We're grateful that you work in our lives in so many ways, that you're so faithful. And Lord, that you, through the gospel, have made a way for us to know you, a way for us to be reconciled to you, a way for us to experience your presence and the resulting joy that it brings to us. And Lord, that you call us to be your representatives. And so thank you for the way the Parahones are representing you down in Nicaragua. We pray your blessing upon them, Lord. We pray that their ministry would be fruitful, Lord, that people would be able to live longer and live a better life because of their ministry. But also, Lord, that people would experience eternal life because of their ministry. And so, Lord, we pray for your blessing upon what they're doing down there. Pray for Tonio as well as he goes down, and for Linda, be with them, keep them safe. also think of Becca Setta. Lord, keep her safe down there in Peru and bless her studies. Lord, we pray for Laura's Aunt Muriel, and thank you that she's home, and we pray that you continue to heal her. Thank you for your work in her life. Lord, we pray for Bob Church today. We pray that you would be strengthening him and healing his body. We pray for Jack Whiteside, Kathy's brother. We pray that you would be continuing to heal Jack and to show him your mercy. Thank you for the progress that has been made, and continue to heal him, we pray. We pray for Ben and Emily, Lord, continue to work in their lives and strengthen them and heal them. Be with Claudia Peterson as well. Give her your strength. Lord, we're grateful for your faithfulness and for your love. And we entrust all these things to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Ushers, come forward. We'll take more time to talk.
Thank you.
majesty, your awesome presence. Lord, what a day that will be. Thank you that you have called us to be your people. You've called us to be a people who are filled with hope because you have made great promises to us and you are a keeper of your promises. Lord, we want more people to know you, more people to experience the goodness of you and the freedom of the gospel, the freedom of being forgiven. And so, Lord, we ask that you would use this offering, bless it, and use it to cause your church to be faithful, to be strong, to be effective and fruitful in bringing your message and bringing your love to this community and beyond. And so we look to you, Lord, and trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Please be seated. Time for the kids to head off to junior church. Down with them and stood on a level place. A large crowd of his disciples was there, and a great number of people from all over Judea, from Jerusalem, and from the coast of Tyre and Sidon, who had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. Those troubled by evil spirits were cured, and the people all tried to touch him, because power was coming from him and healing them all. Looking at his disciples, he said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when men hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven. For that is how their fathers treated the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have already received your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now, for you will go hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all men speak well of you, for that is how their fathers treated the false prophets." Let's pray. Father, we pray that as we go into your word this morning, we pray that you would be with us, that you would speak to us, that you would open this up to us. We thank you that you have given us your word. You've spoken through the apostles and prophets, and you have preserved your word through the ages that we might understand who you are, understand your values, understand who you call us to be. And so, Lord, continue the process of transforming us by renewing our minds. Have your way in the hearts of your people this morning, and help us to be people who not only hear your word, but who live it out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Continuing our series on the ministry of Jesus in the book of Luke, looking at some of the interactions that Jesus had with people, today we're looking at some of his teaching. And so today's sermon is Love Without Prejudice. God loves all people, and all people without prejudice. He doesn't favor different groups. He equally loves the rich and the poor. I want to qualify that statement by helping us to understand that even though God equally loves the rich and the poor, he does have special compassion for people who are poor, for people who are struggling, for people who are oppressed. You know, we see this in Jesus' ministry, where at one point he says, "Sell all your possessions and give to the poor, and great will be your reward in heaven." He also said, "If you have a banquet, Invite the poor and the needy. He's saying invite the people that are excluded. Invite the people that are not valued by society. And once again, you will be greatly rewarded. Jesus, in that case, was dealing with the patronage system. You see, the ancient cultures in the Bible dealt on a patronage system of relationships where people would connect with people of like class and economic situation, and they would, that's where they would make their connections for business and for, they would be like, you help me and I'll help you. And so if you had a banquet, you were to invite people that were of your same social level and same economic level, or you would invite people who were more well off than you with the hope that you could benefit from knowing this person. That if you somehow serve them or bless them in some way, that maybe they would favor you at another time. And so you wouldn't be inclined to invite people that were poor and people that were struggling, or the homeless or the widows, the people that were left out in large part by society and by opportunity. You wouldn't invite those people because they really couldn't help you. And so what Jesus is doing here when he says, when you have a banquet, don't just invite your friends and don't invite the wealthy and the well-to-do. Invite the poor. Invite the broken. Invite the hurting. And great will be your reward in heaven. He's actually going after systemic injustice, because the patronage system kept the poor down. It kept them from having opportunity, from having connections that would help them in life. And so, yes, Jesus has great compassion for the poor. But we need to understand that he does not love them or value them more. And so when he says, blessed are the poor, he's not saying that the poor are somehow better, more valuable, more loved. Jesus loves without prejudice. And so he equally loves people of different races. He equally loves males and females. However, the world we live in is a broken world. It's a fallen world. And people are often treated with prejudice. And so the world continually affirms people that are seen as admirable, wealthy, successful. You know, the people that are somehow seen as people that we admire, people that are maybe talented, people that are well known. The world continually affirms those people. But the poor are often beaten down in the world. They really don't receive affirmation. They're not getting feedback that's saying, wow, I want to be like you, or I want to be connected to you. No, instead, they're often neglected. People pass them by on the street because it's inconvenient to be considering whether or not I should help this person. And in addition to this, in ancient times and in the culture of Palestine, as well as the other cultures, the world perspective on success was that if you are wealthy, and also if you were healthy, that was a sign that God was favoring you, that God was blessing you. And so somehow you were special in the eyes of God. But if you think that way, then how are you going to look at people that are poor? How are you going to look at people that are born blind? Remember how the disciples said, Lord, who sinned, this guy or his parents, that he should be born blind? And Jesus said, no, you got it all wrong. Nobody sinned. And so they were thinking that if someone's life was going well, it showed that God was blessing them, that God really saw them as a good person. That wasn't really true. You know, different people end up in different circumstances, and sometimes someone ends up wealthy and someone ends up poor, and one of the major factors is, well, what happened in the generations before that? You know, one of the leading indicators of whether or not someone is poor is whether or not they're in an intact family. Well, what happened? Was there family breakdown in the generations before that? Was there family breakdown in their immediate family? And so, you know, we have to be careful not to, if God has blessed us, not to assume it's because we've done life well. We've done life right. There are plenty of people that are incredibly wealthy, and they're very far from God. They have no idea who God is, and their values are very different than God's values, right? So we can't make that assumption about other people. We can't make that assumption about ourselves. So in this context, people sometimes saw being poor as a judgment upon someone's life. And so the poor were shunned. They were excluded. And the teachings of Jesus, in the Old Testament, there were a lot of justice teachings where the prophets would chastise the people for being hypocrites, about how they would worship God, but they wouldn't take care of the poor and the widows and the orphans. And so the Bible, throughout the Bible, there's a lot of teachings on justice and caring for needy people. But in the ancient world, the Gentile ancient world, the concept of caring for the needy and the poor and giving of your own resources to someone who's hurting, it was practically unknown. And so those people were kicked aside, left in the gutter, not cared about. They weren't valuable people, according to that perspective. And so when the gospel starts spreading around, the teachings of Jesus were absolutely radical. And we don't realize that as much because Christian teachings have so penetrated our world, even though, you know, our culture has gone secular to a large degree, but our culture is still very much affected by the Christian teachings we've had for the generations before, and that Western society has had for thousands of years before. Teachings related to how we treat the poor and the needy, as well as other teachings. Teachings about, you know, our need to love those who are our enemies. Teachings about what we do with issues of war and peace. Jesus spoke to social issues as well as, you know, salvation-related issues. And so we need to remember that God's love is for all people. And he longs for all people to turn to him for mercy. Jesus gave two sermons, and sometimes we think they're different versions of the same event that was told in different ways. But today there's something in our text that shows us that the Sermon on the Mount was in Matthew's Gospel. Today this is the Sermon on the Plain. In verse 17, it says, he went down with them and stood on a level place. In Matthew's gospel, he does the exact opposite. He goes up onto a mountain in order to teach the people who are gathered below him. And so this is a very different circumstance, and yet there are a lot of similarities. We find the Beatitudes in Matthew 5 that we're very familiar with. Blessed are the poor, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn. Today's text is from the Sermon on the Plain. There are similarities between the Beatitudes and today's text. For example, in the Beatitudes it says, blessed are the poor in spirit. Today's text says, blessed are the poor. The Beatitudes says, blessed are those who mourn. Today's text, blessed are those who weep. The Beatitude says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Today's text says, blessed are the hungry. Now, there's similar wording in these two sermons. I think it's possible that Jesus is actually dealing with two different subjects. Now, I might be wrong about this. This is an interpretation. But if you look at Matthew 5, if you look at the Beatitudes, there's a spiritual progression in what Jesus says. Blessed are the poor in spirit. He's addressing spiritual needs. And poverty of spirit is when we come to the place where we realize that I have nothing to bring before God to make me acceptable to him. It's where our heart has to come to before we can respond to the gospel and know that we need a Savior. That we're poor in spirit and we cannot deserve the acceptance of a holy God. Then it says, blessed are those who mourn. It's not talking about mourning for our lost loved ones. It's talking about mourning over the sin we become aware of as we turn to Jesus. It says, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. What are we comforted by? We're mourning because we've realized our poverty of spirit. We've heard the gospel. We're repenting and turning to God. What are we comforted by? The gospel. That as we grieve over our sin and how we have offended God, when we're realizing it for the first time, we're comforted because God says, you are forgiven. You are clean because my son died in your place. Then it talks about, blessed are the meek. Meekness is strength under control. It's sometimes compared to a team of powerful horses that are controlled well by the driver. Blessed are the meek. A way that it tells us how we are to handle ourselves and our own strength that we've been given, but we're to handle it in a way that is loving and good and appropriate. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, hunger and thirst for God's ways and for the Holy Spirit in our lives. Jesus is righteousness, hungering and thirsting for Him, for more of Him in our lives. And it says, we will be filled. Not that our stomachs will be filled, that our spirits will be filled. Blessed are the merciful. Now it begins to talk about us taking on the characteristics of God. God says that because He's shown mercy to us in the gospel, we are to be merciful people, caring for those around us. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart. Once again, God is moving in a progression as He transforms us as we walk with Him. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. God is the God of peace, and He wants us to be people of peace, that we're not people who hold grudges, who take offenses and hold on to them, and not forgive people around us. He says, I've forgiven you, forgive one another. Be peacemakers. Be like me. And if you are a peacemaker, you will be called a son of God. You will be like your Father. And finally, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. And so that in our lives walking with Christ, as we bear witness, as we do things on in His name, there are times when people come against us, when people reject us. But we're told that we're blessed as we're persecuted because of righteousness. For ours will be the kingdom of God. And so I believe that in the Sermon on the Mount, there's a spiritual progression that he's talking about. And these blessings are the process of coming, the process of conversion and transformation as we grow in our relationship with Christ. But today's text has similar wording, but I think Christ might have a different purpose. Because he doesn't say, blessed are the poor in spirit. The writer limits it to blessed are the poor. And he talks about those who weep. He talks about hungering rather than hungering for righteousness. It's possible that he's talking about physical hunger rather than spiritual hunger in this context. And that rather than mourning over sin, he's talking about weeping about suffering. So what is Jesus' point? Is he saying that somehow the poor are blessed, they're favored by God, and they have somehow an in with him to get to heaven? No, I don't think he's saying that, because God favors neither the rich nor the poor. What he is doing, I believe, is speaking a word of hope to those who are painfully challenged by life, to those whom the world continually says, you're worthless. We have no need of you. We have no place for you. And figure out how you're going to take care of yourself. For the first time in many cultures, for the first time the gospel comes, and through the gospel it's proclaimed that God loves the poor. God cares about them. That they are not rejected, that they are included. They're included in God's people should they choose to place their faith in Jesus and the gospel. They will be included in heaven. That God in no way devalues them or sees them as less than because of their circumstances in life. On the other hand, why is Jesus saying things like, in today's passage, he's speaking woes to those who are well off. Woe to you who are rich. Woe was a word of, the prophets would use that word. It introduced a warning to people, warning of God's judgment. Why is he speaking that way to rich people? Is God prejudiced against rich people? No. I think what he's doing is he's speaking a word of warning to those who always hear affirming words from the world. Now, if your culture around you tells you that your wealth is evidence that God favors you and that you're living right, you know, it's very possible that you won't see your need for God. You don't need to see your need for the gospel because you already have evidence that you're a good guy. And God's already proving that he loves me and he favors me because look at my life. I think that was what the young rich ruler came to Jesus with. Good teacher, what must I do to inherit the kingdom of God? And he's thinking, in their cultural context, he's thinking, I'm wealthy. I already know God favors me. Look at the evidence of it around me. And I think what he's looking for is for Jesus in public to say to him, oh, you don't have to do anything. You're already great. You're a wonderful guy. You're righteous. Look at your life. Instead, Jesus cuts that out from underneath him. What does he say? He says, go sell all that stuff. And what is he saying? He's saying, go sell the very stuff that you think shows that you're righteous. And follow me. And so these two groups are addressed very differently. You know, we see this in the gospel as well, in the various letters in the New Testament. In James 1, 9 and 10, those who are challenged and those who are well off are addressed very differently. It says, the brother in humble circumstances ought to take pride in his high position, but the one who is rich should take pride in his low position, because he will pass away like a wild flower. What is he doing? He's bringing the gospel home to them again. Because in the gospel, the reality is true that we're all sinners, but we're all accepted by God through Jesus. But those who are poor, because the world is always giving them these negative messages, saying that they're unacceptable and that they're failures, and he's saying, if you're poor, you need to focus more on the reality of who you are in Christ, that God loves you, that he accepts you, that the world's message to you is not true. And so consider who you are in Christ. But then he says to the wealthy, the ones that are in the high position in society, he says, consider what a low position you have before God. What he's saying is, you need to realize that you're a sinner like the rest of us. And you need to focus on the fact that you're saved by grace alone. And that your wealth has nothing to do with proving you to be a righteous person. And so, the world's already telling you that you're wonderful. You don't need to focus on that too much. You need to focus on the reality that you're a sinner who needs the grace of God. And so, a word of hope to the poor. Verses 20 and 21 of today's passage, it says, blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Although the world tells you that you are undeserving, Jesus says, I tell you that the kingdom of God is yours. It is fully available to you. You are not excluded, regardless of what people around you tell you, regardless of what society says to you. I open my arms to you. I invite you. I want you to come to me. Your poverty is not a sign of judgment or prejudice. It's not a sign of God not favoring you. Come to me. Then you suffer hunger now, but I will satisfy you. I implore you. I love you. My grace is available to you. You are not excluded. You weep now, but joy is in your future. I have good plans for you. John 14. Matthew 11, 28. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I think that's the type of thing that Jesus is saying to the poor people who have received such negative messages from society. He's saying, come to me. Come to me. Don't stay away because you think I somehow favor those who are wealthy. I have a heart for you in the midst of your brokenness. Come to me. I have good plans for you. John 14, 1 through 3. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me where I am, so that you also may be where I am. It's not that that statement is being said to poor people alone, but I think that's the heart of the things that Jesus is saying in today's sermon, for the reason that people that are struggling, especially in the context of this scripture, are often receiving those negative messages. And then finally he says, you may be persecuted now for loving me, but you will be rewarded. Luke 6, 22-23. Blessed are you when men hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven. For that is how their fathers treated the prophets. You will be richly rewarded when you suffer persecution and you're in the good company of the prophets. Now that statement is true for all of us. No matter what our station in life is, no matter what our economic situation is. But I believe the point today, part of Jesus' point, is he's reaching out to people that that culture has left behind. And he's basically saying, I don't leave you behind. I love you. I value you. And if that's his heart, what is our heart when we see broken people? Do we judge them for their circumstances? You know, we've never walked in that person's shoes. We don't know what they've had to deal with in life. You know, what their brokenness is, what their pains have been. We don't know the roots of their issues. And we have to be careful not to say, oh, not to write someone off or not to respond to them with prejudice. God has a very compassionate heart for the broken. I believe no matter how they got there, he wants us to have that heart. He wants us to have that heart. He wants us to be his hands that would reach out with his love, with his compassion. And then Jesus gives this word of warning to the prosperous. I think, you know, there is one advantage that, like I said, I don't think Jesus is saying that poor people are somehow more loved or that it's better in God's eyes that someone be poor. But in one sense, there's an advantage to be poor. And that's this. Jesus at one point said, it is more difficult for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God than it is for a camel pass through the eye of a needle. Why is that? And personally, I don't think he's just talking about financial wealth. I think he's talking about rich in many ways. You know, there are many things that we consider our riches. It can be our popularity, our personality, our ability to interact with people. For some people, it's some ability they've been given that sets them apart. Sporting ability, an ability in the arts, some strength. It can be how people look. It can be fame. It can be many things that we can see as our riches. But sometimes we believe that those are the things that we can depend on in life, as well as financial wealth. And I was trying to explain this. I was doing the jail ministry the other day, and someone said, well, why does God care about whether someone's rich or whether they're rich or not? Why, how does that make a difference? And what came to mind for me was that very few people come to Christ when life is hunky-dory, you know? We usually come to Christ when we're in a painful situation and we're broken. Why is that? Because we depend upon ourselves until then. And we think we're good enough to save ourselves, and we think we're doing okay at life, and we're having a good time, and I don't really need God. And so God brings us to a place of crisis when we finally surrender to Him. I know for me, I came to a place where I considered suicide at one point, right before I became a Christian. I was broken. But I had been running away from God for years. And now I look back at that time and I say, thank you, God. Thank you. I praise you. That painful time in my life is the best blessing you ever gave me because it brought me to my knees. And I am here today saved and going to heaven and loving my Savior because I was a broken person. Praise God for the brokenness. Well, what about the person who never experiences brokenness? It can be very difficult for them to get into heaven. Why? They never see a need for the gospel. They never see a need to be rescued. They never see a need for God. I'm doing okay on my own, thank you. Brokenness can be the greatest blessing. So I was explaining to the guys in jail, and the ladies too, I was saying, this could be the best thing that ever happened to you if you allow it to be. If you allow the brokenness of the situation to turn your heart to God and you find your Savior here, you will celebrate this time for the rest of your life, and God will redeem this time because He will use this brokenness to bless the lives of other people. Praise God for the times when He allows us to be broken. And so Jesus says, woe to you who are rich and comfortable now, because without Jesus, you will lose your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now. Unless you are hungry for God now, you will not be full in your future. Woe to you who laugh now, who have no concern for the significant things, the eternal things. This is not a statement against joy. God wants us to experience His joy. It's against superficiality. If superficiality keeps you from Jesus, you will weep later. You know, you can have the party spirit. Yay, life is a big party. You will weep later if that never changes. I walk that walk, and it is very superficial. Shouldn't it be good if people speak well of you? And yet Jesus says, woe to you when all men speak well of you, for that is how their fathers treated the false prophets. You see, if everyone speaks well of you, are you really saying anything that matters? Because the gospel confronts people. And so when you're sharing the gospel, there are times when people get offended by it, because to understand the gospel, we need to understand that we're sinners, and sometimes people don't like to hear that. And so if everybody thinks you're wonderful, are you ever rocking the boat? Are you ever speaking truth? That's what Jesus is saying. So if everybody's speaking well of you, you're in the company of the false prophets. Yikes, right? And so Jesus is emphasizing the truth of the gospel. And that ultimately, rich or poor, we only have one real hope for salvation, and that's the gospel. And that, you know, if people in different circumstances need different approaches. And so for the broken one, Jesus says, I don't reject you. The gospel is open to you. Come to me. And for the person who's full of pride, He says, get off your high horse and come to me. Because all our sinners who are loved by God, and every single one of us, desperately needs the gospel. We desperately need the grace of God. The poor need hope, the rich need warning, and we all need Jesus. Let's pray as the praise team comes forward. Father, we are so grateful for the gospel. We are so grateful for the many different ways in which you came into our lives and the circumstances you brought us through in order to soften our hearts and to help us to surrender to you, to realize our need for you, and to turn our hearts toward you to find your love and your grace in the gospel. And so thank you. Lord, help us to be a people like you, a people who love without prejudice, a people who care for the poor and needy. And Lord, we pray that we would not think too much of ourselves in whatever our circumstances are, that we would be humble like you are, Jesus, and that we would know that we are saved not because of how we have lived, but because of how you lived and because of how you died, because you came to rescue us. And we love you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stay together now and sing "I Surrender All," hymn number 499.
His presence stays. Yeah, I noticed they didn't set my watch for it, so I'm just in an hour and a half long sermon. Receive the blessing of our Lord today. Now may the one who loves us all without prejudice, may he continue to help you to experience the fullness of his love as you meet with him. May you soak deeply within that love, and as a result, may your life be full of Jesus. May your life overflow, that you might love those around you, that you, like your Savior, might love without prejudice. Be blessed. Have a great week. If you have any kind of need, any kind of emergency need, please contact Maggie, and she'll get a hold of me, and I'll give you a call. Thanks.
Yeah, so it doesn't make sense. No one knows.
Hey, was he the kitchen center
trying to do this?
No.
Yes. Yeah. I'm still the orchestra says it's repeating as it's a measure of that.
It's not funny, that's like
15 times.
But that is exactly, she's supposed to be shy.
We don't need to get
it.
And backstage, the expo.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.